All right, as we continue our rolling coverage here on SABC News, lots of reaction, condolences coming in for the late former Zimbabwean President Robert Mugabe. Now, SABC Foreign Editor Sophie Mokoena and a radio anchor and journalist Aldrin Sampear are amongst the journalists who witnessed the fall of Robert Mugabe. Let's talk to them now about that particular aspect and much more. Let me start with you, Sophie Mokoena. Thanks for your time. I mean, after decades of rule, you were in Zimbabwe together with Aldrin Sampear and myself when the face of Zimbabwean politics had basically changed. Robert Mugabe was being forced out.
Yes, indeed. It was a historic moment. Remember, I got a tip off that it looks like President Robert Mugabe will resign. And then Effet Musekua, our correspondent in Zimbabwe, covered the build-up in terms of protest in the streets when they were really pushing for Robert Mugabe to vacate the office, and the military, when the military was deployed in the streets. And then we took a decision as the team of the SABC to go to Zimbabwe. And on arrival, we could see that, the writing was on the wall, that the reality has dawned to many Zimbabweans that President Robert Mugabe might leave power. But then, typical of President Robert Mugabe, he was very defiant, refusing to accept the recommendations by those who were mediating, among them George Charamba, a person who was his spokesperson, a person who was very close to him, and also Constantino Chiwenga, the general. Mm-hmm. But finally, it did happen. And you'd recall, you landed and immediately went to the streets to cover the story. And Aldrin, on the other hand, was also in the streets covering the story. And all of us, we ended up having to really cross life and giving updates in terms of what's happening.
Yeah. Aldrin, Mam Sophie speaks about, the defiance. Mm-hmm. And even though the writing was on the wall, talk to us a bit about that moment where it all seemed that it was going to go one way, but he had dug his heels in.
Yeah.
He was not going to go anywhere.
Yeah, certainly. I remember how we were running around the newsroom and trying to find as much information as we can as possible. And then we were told later that evening that Robert Mugabe will have a press briefing. And we thought that, this is it. He is going to resign. And I remember listening to that press briefing and I was like, no, man, this guy is not resigning. This guy is giving a State of the Nation address that actually I'm not leaving at all. And I remember there was news about a little paper that was being passed. And later we understood that we were told that the expectation was indeed that he was going to resign on that day at that press briefing. But certainly that didn't happen. He was still willing to fight.
Asante moment.
Yes.
Asante sana.
Yes. A lot is being said about his legacy now. You know, you talk about the liberator, you talk about the dictator. How would you describe the legacy, Imam Sophie, of this man who was described as a great African hero by some, but many are saying don't forget the contribution that he made towards Zimbabwe's downfall?
Yes, some might say it's a project gone wrong, a dream deferred. Because you have different views, you know, it depends who you speak to. You have those who still revered him until the last moment, but there are those who are very critical based on what happened during the twilight of his life and also his career. Now, the problem is it will be very difficult to really say he was just a dictator or he was good, because half of what he did upon taking power, many believe it was good work in terms of investing in education, also liberating the country. But then things changed when he started implementing the economic policies and also the land policy. He would argue all the time that the issue of the land, why there was a fallout. He felt that the British government didn't follow up in terms of the Lancaster Agreement, and therefore the hostility between Mugabe and the West started there. Therefore, Mugabe, there was a good Mugabe in earlier years, and of course there was a problematic Mugabe towards the end.
And that problematic Mugabe led then to the fall. Aldrin, what was it like covering that fall? Mm-hmm. You were in Zimbabwe way before I had arrived. Mm-hmm. What was it like? I remember driving from the airport and I just saw people stopping in the middle of the road. And, you know, all you could see was the flag. And mm-hmm. when I tried to find out what was happening, I turned on the radio. And that's when I got to learn. What was it like covering that particular moment mm-hmm. that most thought would never come?
Yeah. And remember that just a year before that, it was the African Union Summit, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
A year or two before that he stepped down as mm-hmm. the chairperson of the AU. There he said, and in response to Obama, that there are people who want to push regime change, and regime change shall not happen. And there I thought that this is a man who's arguing that if my people say that I must remain in power, as he was saying when he was here on a visit with former President Jacob Zuma, on an official visit to, when Jacob Zuma was still the president of the country. And he spoke about this issue around a term limit. And then on the other end, you had Obama, who said that people must know when to leave. You can't overstay your welcome, even as a leader. Mm-hmm. Ian Khama made the same sentiments, argued the same, that now it's time for you to step down. And at that moment, when you had all the celebrations happening in Zimbabwe, and in the package I also speak about, it almost became the second independence of Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. So sad that someone who has fought for the liberation of the country would later on become the villain and would become the person that the people want to overthrow. Even those, as he said in that in the press briefing, by those he thought were his comrades, mm. who would later betray him. Mm.
And then everyone thought, Mum Sophie, that was going to usher in a new era. Mm. The contestation began almost immediately. Talk to us a bit about that, because once there'd been all that celebration, once they thought this new era was going to come, talk to us about what followed after that.
Well, of course, at that time, the current president, Emmerson Mnangagwa, who was fired by former President Robert Mugabe, was in South Africa in exile. And he went back, and we were there when he arrived. People were on the streets receiving him, and there was hope. And then the election campaign started, and hostility was there again between the ruling party and the oppositions. And finally, elections indeed happened. And of course, there was again tense moments where the opposition rejected the election results. I remember very well when they stormed the Electoral Commission center. And then later in the streets, protests, you were there. And Aldrin Sampear can tell us much better in terms of when he was in the streets mm-hmm. and people taking to the streets, rejecting the results.
Yeah. Yeah. And the thing about that that was quite interesting, Griselda, is that just the day before, remember, not a day before, but 2 or 3 days before, but a day before the elections, there was a press briefing with Mugabe.
Yes.
And he kept on speaking about how he has been betrayed and kept on speaking about where have you ever seen tanks rolling onto the streets, who are they fighting? It would seem that they are fighting their own people. And then a couple of days later, you have the election results about to be declared, but already the opposition are refusing the results. They're refusing even the preliminary results that were coming out, hitting on the streets, and they were protesting. And then all of a sudden, I remember being in front of the headquarters, the ZANU-PF headquarters, and all of a sudden, the tankers started rolling in. The tanks started rolling in, and the army were on the streets of Zimbabwe. Okay. And for me, it was the first time that I've seen the army actually being, or any army for that matter, being in action. I've never witnessed anything of that nature. I remember watching this one woman, I can't remember whether she had a baby or not, but she was running from the soldiers.
Yeah.
And she jumped onto a moving taxi. Mm-hmm. She jumped onto a moving taxi. That's how scared they were. Yeah. And that's where the other complexities then come in, that this same army that was celebrated just the year before for having helped with the removal of Robert Mugabe, all of a sudden is the same army that would become the enemy of the people.
But what was interesting also, Mum Sophie, on the eve of that election, we saw a very defiant Robert Mugabe who had basically been abandoning his party, mm-hmm. questioning how his own party would turn against him. Talk to us a bit about that.
Yes, I remember receiving a call in the morning that day from my contact in Zimbabwe saying, rush, go to the Blue Roof. Blue Roof is former President Mugabe's private residence. When I arrived at the Blue Roof, journalists were calling each other, and then all of a sudden, lots of journalists were there. And then here's President Mugabe, press conference. His message was clear. He was abandoning his party at an 11th hour. And he uttered words that I will never forget. He said, I will never vote for those who have tormented me. And clearly, he was going to put his ex somewhere. And thereafter, ZANU-PF was not happy about what happened. Remember, President Emmerson Mnangagwa took to Twitter and also expressing his disappointment. And the next day, President Mugabe went to the polls and he was warmly received. And clearly, he was happy that perhaps that moment has arrived where he was able to express his views. But later, things changed. When the First Lady's mother of Grace Mugabe, died, then the government had to help because Grace was in Singapore, also receiving medical attention. And then the Zimbabwean government assisted the family to bury the mother of Grace Mugabe. And I remember seeing visuals where Grace Mugabe was addressing people, crying, really singing praises, you know, in terms of what Mnangagwa has done to them. And it was like they have healed. But now recently, there were reports that he is still aggrieved. You'd recall when I had a one-on-one with him where he spoke to the media for the first time after he was removed from power, saying that he will never, never accept what happened because he believes it's a coup. And therefore, that was President Robert Mugabe and his family feeling very strong that there was a coup, and therefore he was removed unceremoniously and not following democracy.
Yeah. Aldrin, fast forward to the election, of course, after all of that had happened. The election results, for example, I mean, you were on the streets at the time. What was the sentiment then when that announcement was made?
When the announcement was made, because the day before, if I'm not mistaken, that's the day before that the army was on the streets of the CBD in Harare. One of the most striking things for me was we went to go buy food. I think I was with Tula Caesar Simelani, if I'm not mistaken. We went to go buy food at one of the garages, but the streets were quiet. It was eerie.
Deserted.
At some point, someone said to us, just get in your cars and go. Get in your cars and leave. And we had to leave because then you had the soldiers patrolling the streets in the evening, but some of them had balaclavas on, if I'm not mistaken. And that for me was the strangest thing. We went to some other town then to go and get a tavern where people are waiting on the results.
I remember that.
And that we did find.
Yes.
And for some people, that was the happiest moment of their lives, that now there is a president who has been directly elected by the people of Zimbabwe, of course, through the election of ZANU-PF, and has beaten many others for that particular moment. But on the other end, you had those who had said that we reject this result, and to this very date, the MDC alliance rejects the results that have led to the election of President Emmerson Mnangagwa.
But Zimbabwe is quite strange. I remember I did an interview with Nelson Chamisa months before the elections. And he spoke about President Robert Mugabe, saying President Robert Mugabe was going to vote for MDC. And it was surprising when he really endorsed Chamisa on the eve of the elections.
Yes.
But coming to the announcement of the results, you recall all of us were very, very tense because it is the day where these ZANU-PF supporters took to the election center and they stood there and saying they are not accepting the results. It was quite tense, because it could have, you know, sparked a serious confrontation. But during the protest, you'd recall you were in the streets, and it was very dangerous. I remember saying to you and Tabiso, go to the hotel, go to the hotel, and don't come out.
Yes. Just very quickly, we're about to run out of time. I mean, do we know if the rift or the tension between Robert Mugabe and Emmerson Mnangagwa was ever resolved?
I think with the statements that has been issued by government and the statement that has been issued by ZANU-PF, it would seem as though that they've tried to fix it. They've tried at least to fix issues. But the other thing that we should also take into consideration is at the inauguration, this is now the second inauguration of Emmerson Mnangagwa, where the expectation was and the questions were, will Robert Mugabe come?
That's right.
To show that he accepts the results, and he didn't come. But he sent his daughter Bona.
That's correct.
And this morning on the radio show, I was speaking to one of the reporters in Zimbabwe, and he was saying that that was a sign of Robert Mugabe saying that I've sent my family member, but not just any family member, the woman who bears the name of my mother, Bona, and Bona is there. And by that, that means that we accept the results.
And she was well received.
Certainly,
in fact, she stole the limelight.
Yeah.
All right, I'm afraid that's all we have time for tonight. Thank you very much to you both for joining us here on The Full View. Two of the reporters, of course, SABC Foreign Editor Sophie Mokoena, as well as radio anchor and journalist Aldrin Sampear, who were amongst the journalists who witnessed the fall of Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe.